My name is Thijs van Ede, and I will be presenting our work Flowprint, semi-supervised mobile app fingerprinting on encrypted network traffic. And this was a joint work with all of these wonderful people. But let's look at what we have done in the paper. So we've looked at different mobile applications. And what we've seen is that many of these applications communicate over the internet. And the question that we asked ourselves is, suppose that we are a network operator, and we look at the network traffic that is going over the, that we see going past. Can we distinguish, by just looking at the network traffic, which mobile applications are active on the devices within our network? Now, why would this be useful? For example, you could allow or disallow applications to communicate over the internet. Or suppose that you have an intrusion in your network, you might be able to go back to the network traffic and see what has taken place or which application was responsible for this. Well, this seems like a cool idea, but it's not super easy. Because if we take a look at the network traffic, it doesn't look like this, but it looks more like this. The network traffic is often encrypted, especially in the mobile environment. So it's not very obvious, if you look at just the network traffic or the flows that are within this traffic, which application is active. Furthermore, specifically for mobile applications, they are often built out of what we call components or modules. And these modules, they can be used to, for example, authenticate a user within an application, or they show some analytics. But what that means is that a lot of the network traffic that we see going over the internet looks similar for different applications. We call this network traffic homogeneous. Another challenge that is specific to mobile, or not entirely specific to mobile, but very prominent there, is that a lot of the traffic is generated by the user itself. So depending on what the user does with the application will generate different traffic that has different characteristics. And this is something we would need to deal with. And finally, the applications in a mobile environment are not very static. In fact, they are evolving very often. Think about the ease with which you can remove applications from a mobile device. Or you might install new applications. Applications receive updates. These are all kinds of challenges that make it difficult to determine beforehand what kind of network traffic you can expect, because you won't know what kind of network traffic or what kind of applications are in fact present in the system that you are observing. So this leads us to the question that we had in this work, and that is, can we infer mobile app usage from network traffic without any prior knowledge of the apps that are installed in the environment? Well, we think we can, but first, before we go into that, let me give you a quick intuition of the ideas that we had for this work. And that is, suppose that you have two different apps. They may consist of some of these modules that we talked about before. Some of the modules may be specific to an application, and some of the modules are shared. Now, suppose that we have an app and it communicates with the network traffic. If they communicate with a designated server for this application, then it will be probably pretty easy to distinguish this application from any other in the network traffic. But suppose that the application communicates with a content delivery network. Well, this can be shared among many applications. So by just looking at an individual packet or a flow, it can become very difficult to distinguish the different applications. But of course, the applications that we are talking about don't communicate with just one server. They communicate with many servers. And the idea is that the combination of the servers or services that they communicate with is unique to the application. So that means that if we see these different network destinations with which that traffic is going to, we can distill that application X is active. And if we see these other collection of network destinations, we can guess that application Y is active. that's the core intuition about our work. But now the question is, how do we learn this? Or how do we extract these patterns? Well, to that end, we have developed Flowprint, where we basically go from the raw network data to fingerprints of the different applications. These are the steps that we are taking, and I will go into detail about all of them. But the big overview is that we extract some features. We try to extract the network destinations. In the paper, we talk about the browser isolation. It's basically isolating the browser app because it behaves a little bit different from the rest of the apps. I won't go into detail about that, but feel free to come to me to talk about that if you want to know more. But once we've extracted the network destinations, we do some correlation to check which combination of destinations are active at the same time. We can extract fingerprints from those and then use them in a detection system. So in the first step, we look at each device that we see in the network individually. If we look at this from a network operator point of view, we can have a full overview of the devices within the network, and we can basically separate all of these. Next, we want to distinguish the different destinations or services that they communicate with. And we do that on the basis of the destination IP and destination port, as well as the TLS certificate that we see in the flows. And finally, we want to do some temporal correlation, so we will need the timestamps. Once we have this, we can go on and try to extract the different network destinations. We basically group all of the flows that we see in the network traffic for a specific time period. In our example, this is 5 minutes, or in our work. And we look at whether flows have a similar destination tuple or a similar TLS certificate. And if this is the case, we group the flows together in one of these network destinations. And if we look at this in practice, it will look something like this. These are three randomly chosen applications from our data set, and they produce these different clusters of network destinations. And now, some of these clusters are unique for the application, but a lot of them are shared between applications, which makes the individual clusters difficult to use for detection. So therefore, we want to do some correlation. And the intuition behind this is that network destinations that have communication towards it in a period of time that is close to each other are very likely belonging to the same app. So by looking at temporal correlations, we can extract those patterns and basically see how similar they are. And we do this on the basis of a formula, the cross-correlation formula, which basically says if we see flows going to the same destinations frequently together, we give it a high score, and if it doesn't occur together, we give it a low score. And by using this formula, we are able to transform all of these clusters into a graph, where each edge of the graph represents the cross-correlation. And if we take a closer look at this graph, we can see these dense areas. And if we would color them with the applications that produce them, we get the graph on the right. And we see that the densely correlated areas are created by the same application, whereas there is very little correlation between applications, apart from some central nodes. And these are these shared destinations that I've talked about. So suppose that we have this graph. We now want to extract these clusters as fingerprints. And the way we do that is by looking at the cross correlations between the different nodes. And we remove all the cross correlations with a very low score to get rid of these. What we then do is we try to look for cliques in the graph. And cliques are basically fully connected subgraphs, which allows us to basically distill the fingerprints from the graph. And we represent the fingerprint as the set of destinations. And remember, these are the IP and port tuples and the TLS certificates. Now, once that we have these fingerprints, we of course want to compare them, because we want to use these fingerprints to later detect applications that we've seen before, or maybe even detect applications that we haven't seen before in the network. Now, as we have said, these fingerprints are sets. So the natural metric to compare sets is the Jaccard similarity, which is basically a distance between two sets. So if they are very similar, we get a high score. If they are very distinct, we get a very low score. And we can use this score to match fingerprints. Now, let's take a look at how well we perform. So just to recap, we are looking at the network traffic, and we want to know one of two things. Either, if we've seen an application before, can we recognize it? So if we already have a fingerprint somewhere stored in a database, can we assign it to the correct application? Or if we see a new fingerprint over the network, is it different from the fingerprints that we already know? So can we see whether there's something new going on? Well, we have evaluated this on a couple of data sets, each covering one of the challenges that we've discussed before. So all of the data sets are very homogeneous. So that means they share a lot of the network traffic between applications. For this cross-platform data set, we've also have some actual human interaction. So that means that humans produce the data set, which makes it a bit more realistic. For the Recon data set, we've also looked at applications which have different versions. So basically, this evolving step of the data set. And for the Andrubis data set, there are both benign and malicious applications. Because of course, if you want to use this in a security setting, it's good to know whether it works well in both benign and malicious settings. Now let's take a look at how well our system Flowprint performs. First of all, in recognizing known apps. So we have a database of app fingerprints, and we have some unknown network traffic from which we distill the fingerprints. How well can we correspond the apps, or can we recognize the actual application? And of course, this differs a lot, depending on the amount of applications that we have installed on each device. So with more applications installed, it might be a bit more difficult to distinguish them. But we've still found pretty good numbers with F1 scores of around 90%. We have compared this to supervised detection solutions. So we've compared it with AppScanner, which basically learns fingerprints by first training on data and then trying to recognize that later on, whereas our fingerprints are generated without any training. And we see that we even outperform this supervised solution. We get similar precision scores, but the amount of apps that that AppScanner is able to detect is a lot lower than Flowprint, because they assume that you know beforehand which kind of applications you expect in the network, and that is simply not always the case. Now let's take a look at detecting apps that we haven't seen before in the network traffic. As we can see, for the cross-platform dataset and Recon dataset, we still achieve very high F1 scores. But for the Andrubis dataset, a little bit less. This is because the Andrubis dataset has a very limited amount of traffic that is being generated. So there's a little bit of a low code coverage, which makes it difficult to recognize applications later on. What we did found that there was no discernible difference between the malicious and the benign applications. So that didn't seem to be the cause of this difficulty. So in short, we created Flowprint, a system or an approach that isolates apps within encrypted network traffic. And we don't require prior knowledge on the applications that we want to detect. We've shown that it works even better than some of the supervised detectors. It requires no training. It can recognize known apps, and it can isolate previously unseen apps. We also have made our code available, so if you want to have a play around with it yourself, please feel free to have a look at it. This was my presentation, and are there any questions?
We have quite some time for questions.
I see there's this gentleman already.
So this is Rais Khalil from Qatar Computer Research Institute. My question is, did you see a different behavior when you compare the same application among different users, and can that enhance the accuracy of your fingerprinting?
Yes, so what we've done in our approach is look at this on a per device basis. So we've looked at how well an application that we've trained on one device is being able to be recognized from that same device. In our data set, however, there were also, we have a data set consisting of 5 different devices. And between these devices, we've seen similarities between the fingerprints. We've done a small test on both Android and iOS devices, so with the same app for Android, where we trained it and tested it with the app from iOS and vice versa. And this seemed to work not so well, because the underlying operating system introduces a lot of differences between the fingerprints. So the data set that we have is a little bit too small to make any concrete conclusions about. But it seemed that for the apps are transferable, but not between operating systems.
So just a quickly another question. I don't understand why your approach, because it's between known and unknown apps, you have different results. It's supposed to be the same, because your approach does not take into consideration any prior knowledge about the apps, right?
That's
so
true.
I wonder why it's different.
So the difference is, if we have a database of only known apps, we try to see how well we match the newly generated fingerprint to the exact fingerprint that we have in the database of the corresponding app. Whereas in the unknown database, or in the unknown setting, we say, okay, suppose that we have this new fingerprint. Is it different enough from all the fingerprints that we have in the database to be considered new, or is it similar enough to one of the known applications? So that's where the discrepancy comes from.
Maybe we can take that question offline. And can we go to the back just to rotate among the two microphones?
Yes, please.
Okay. Hi, Tim van Hammer from the University of Leuven. I was wondering, there is quite an extensive body of work on de-anonymizing Tor traffic with website fingerprinting. How is your use case different, and why can't you use similar techniques?
So the use case is different in that we look at mobile apps instead of websites. The difference between mobile apps and websites is that the mobile app has different components running within the app, so that basically different components communicate with different sources across the network, whereas in web fingerprinting, you can rely on, basically many different, so especially for Tor networks, you have basically a set of network destinations that all use this Tor service, which makes it a bit more, they share the fewer modules, which makes it a different setting, basically. Does that answer your question?
Not entirely, I think, but thank you.
Okay. Maybe we can take it offline if you...
Let's do the offline discussion.
Cool. This was very interesting. Thank you. My name is Xander. I'm from Oregon State University. I'm curious if you're doing any work on fingerprinting with DNS instead of just the layer 3 information, since more modern applications be more transient from the layer 3 information.
Yes. We didn't do the work on DNS fingerprinting. We did have a look at including DNS as a feature for the network destinations. In our data sets, we didn't have all the DNS traffic available, so we choose not to include it. But my gut feeling is that it would strengthen the detection of
perfect. Thank you.
Network destinations.
One last question.
Oh. Man, the pressure. Hi, Thijs. Thanks for a great talk.
Thank you.
My name is Ben Grash from the VU University in Amsterdam. And one thing I'm interested in, which I couldn't quite make up from your talk, is how do you collect ground truth information?
Yes, that's a great question. So I've mentioned the 3 data sets that we have. These were produced by prior work. Depending on the work, there are of course slight discrepancies in how the data set was produced. But basically, some of the data sets were created by running Android apps in a simulated environment, whereas others were created by having users install a specific app, interact with it, and then deinstalling the applications. And because the data sets were produced this way, we could have exact labels for which traffic was produced by which application.
I see. Thank you.
You're welcome.
All right. So thanks to our speaker again.
Thank you very much.